morning, everybody. I didn't know Brian, but out of respect and deference for him, maybe we ought to dedicate ourselves this morning to making today the most gratifying, enjoyable, and fun day we can make. Okay? So, when I got the invitation to come and speak, I was really quite excited about it because I thought that the theme of today, redefining we, was a great, fascinating, and provocative one. So I was quite into this. I was really excited to come and talk to you. And I've got my first TED experience this morning. I don't know how many other people are having their first TED experience, but we're bound by rules of brevity and time. So in order to be compliant with that, I'm going to move through a pretty expansive topic in a very short period of time. So this is going to move fast. Stay with me. Okay? It is, think of it like pre-gaming. Okay? Okay, so, redefining we. As I thought about this, I thought, well, you know, this is pretty fascinating. How do we define ourselves in the 21st century? Because it's not really possible to redefine we if we don't know how we define me. Right? There's no we without me. So I started to think about the implications of us as a collective group, but if we don't know how to define ourselves, the group becomes less definable, almost clear. So remember, if I go through this, this topic of redefining we really starts from how we define ourselves, and how do we define ourselves in the 21st century? And do we do it, or do others do it for us? So how have we done this over the centuries, and how will we do it in the years ahead? Given our changing world, how much control do we have over defining who we are? And the fact is that over the centuries, it's always been a balance. It's always been a balance of us expressing who we are and who we want to be and who we want to be known for, and others who we affiliate with and interact with defining us. So what I tried to capture in this slide is just a sense where you start back from the first me, right? You move through the journey of civilization in a way where we constantly started interacting with more and more people, tribes, communities, cities, and we started to take on the characteristics as well as the attributes of this larger group that we were interacting with. And those people who were interacting with us were defining us, and we were defining ourselves frequently as being a part of that group. Now we have the benefit throughout most of history to be able to control this because we could determine what I wanted to say to you this morning and what you took from that and how you would define me. But the benefit of control was around proximity. It was really our spoken word and where we work geographically and physically. And that was pretty much the case. You want to take it all the way up through the world of nations, where we were having one-way communication, not instantaneous two-way communication that we have today. So then what happened? So then we had this thing, this phenomenon called the internet-driven digital world come upon us. Come upon us in the mid-90s in a very popularized way, where the internet became the connective tissue of civilization. Wow, all of a sudden, boundaries of geography and proximity were broken. Then what happened? Well, with the advent of mobile computing, instantaneous communications, we became inseparable from each other. We end up in a digital and a physical me. So the me that was way down here, that I could control pretty easily, as it was physical, started to really morph, and then up in the upper right, we now have multiple personas. We have a digital persona that may or may not even be connected to your physical persona. You could have an avatar, right? Is that avatar anything like you? Or is it somebody else defining you? So it was a pretty fascinating conversation I had with myself as we went through all this. And I said, well, we'll see where this goes, you know? Maybe there'll be more, maybe not, but TED's about sharing ideas, and this is what I'm thinking about, so hopefully you'll enjoy it, and we'll move through it. So now, let me give you a snapshot. As we've moved through this journey of civilization, what I really want you to think about is this balance between us defining ourselves and somebody else defining us. Has that radically changed in the 21st century? Has it changed so much that the balance is now skewed to the social interaction piece, to the others defining us, versus us defining ourselves? And we'll see. We'll see what you think at the end of this. This is a, let me give you a couple of snapshots of things today and tomorrow. This is a recent Zogby poll that describes how Americans are currently defining ourselves. Up here, look at this. Citizens of the planet Earth. In total, 14%. Okay, so that's probably 50 million people in the United States define themselves not as U.S. citizens, but as citizens of planet Earth. Now, in your age cohort, it's the highest. It's growing, by the way. This is a snapshot of December 2011. But these numbers have been constantly increasing. And the fascinating thing is that old people like me are going up even more. So that the internet generation, the mobile generation, the YouTube generation, the text messaging generation, of which you are mostly it, is now being joined by the rest of us. So we're defining ourselves in non-traditional ways about the resident, or the town, or the nation state. Interesting. Now, let's talk about the world of today from a different lens. In my interest, I've always been fascinated at the intersection between the economic dimension of social interaction. And so what does all this mean for the economic dimension of our lives and how we define ourselves economically? So let me show you a couple of snapshots. Here's the world today in terms of the 10 largest economies as a percentage of the 2011 global GDP. United States being the largest, probably doesn't surprise you. China being second, may or may not surprise you. Right? Japan and India fundamentally being third, because of, this is in purchasing power parity terms. Okay. Now, in a little less than 10 years, here's the same snapshot of the world from an economic dimension. How we are defining ourselves economically as a global community in an economic filter. China becomes the largest economy. And well, not necessarily the richest, but the largest. The United States second. India clear third. Japan. Italy falls off the screen. Mexico's added to the screen. Now, what about in your lifetime? Maybe not in mine, but in your lifetime. In 2050. China. India number two by a large margin. Okay. Brazil overtake, then United States. Brazil overtakes Japan. France falls off the screen. Indonesia's added to it. Pretty fascinating economic dimension shifts. So what does this mean to how we define we, right, in a global context? Just one way, just an economic filter, an economic lens. But what we see is a new shifting definition of the economic we in the world in which we live in. Right. Now, pay attention, because this moves fast. 21st century is characterized, at least in my opinion, by three fundamental attributes. Speed, right? I tried to depict those here on the graph. Transparency, right? And us, right? The concept of us, the concept of larger communities, both digital and physical. Right? Now, who defines us in this new world? Well, you know, we have a very robust digital footprint, digital identity that we're all dealing with. And the question is, can you control it in the manner in which you were able to control your definition of me prior to this? And I think we all know that the answer is not as much as we used to, right? Is that a good thing? Is it a bad thing? We don't know yet. We're going to find out, right? We're living through this experiment right now. So, but the real question is, has the balance for defining ourselves been shifted to others in such a way that we may not be able to get it back? Okay? So, in today's economy, there are fundamentally four types of data that are floating around the world, both physical and digital, about us. And this gives you a little bit of a sense for what those kinds of data are. We have individual identity data, your typical name, social security number, national ID number if you're in other countries. birth dates, etc., behavioral data, location data, because your cell phone is on, or your smartphone is on, they know you're here, right? Or at least they know your cell phone's here. They may not know that you're here. Right? Purchase history, digital, online, offline, non-identifiable web browsing, travel preferences, call center transcripts. You call and say, well, why isn't my Windows 7 working? They end up tracking a history of that, which is good and bad. It helps you sometimes, and it kind of creates another footprint for yourself, good or bad. Derived data from all this activity. Right? What's your credit score? What's your propensity score? Your persona? Your influence score? All these things are kind of new dimensions of our digital identity in the 21st century. Self-identified data, purchase intent, I'm letting you know I'm going to go out and purchase a new iPad. Come to me and tell me what's the best deal you can give me, right? Or what should I be looking for? Social media likes, etc. So the good news here is that there's a lot of economic analysis that's begun around, in my opinion, around this question of the new economic footprint and identity we have. So organizations like the World Economic Forum, Forrester Research, New York Times, are starting to pay a lot of attention to this new world, which is who defines me, given all of this information that is floating in our world today about us and about others. So this is an example of some of the thoughts and the analysis that's taking place, which is to think about in the 21st century where information is instantaneous and pervasive, is your personal data like the new oil? Is it fueling the economy? Is it fueling our society? And if it's like the new oil, what does that mean to you, since you are the generator, the supplier of this new economic asset? Right? So there are studies that are taking place about the new asset class. All of us, because we have information about us, are producing the new fuel that drives the world today. So is your personal data the new oil? Interesting question. And there are startups like this one being profiled in the New York Times called Personal, that are helping each and every one of us figure out what are our privacy values, what are our privacy preferences, what do we want for the use of our personal information, who should we give it to, who should we trust with it, what are the terms and conditions of this very collaborative, very visible, very transparent, very fast world we're living in. Okay? So in our digital and physical world of today, the shift is taking place to all of us being able to perhaps redefine who we are in a more controlled way because of developments such as this. So, interesting in my opinion and fortunate that we have this market-oriented attention being given to this concept of who we are and how we define ourselves and who we let in and what capacity do we have to be forgotten in a very transparent global world. So, when you think about it, there's hope, right? It's not, if the horse isn't out of the barn, it still has a rein on it, might be a long rein. The question for us is, do we want to hold on to the reins? Right? Do we care? Well, we want to take advantage of this trend, such as the ability to start taking control and give access to our identity in a new digital and physical world with a robust digital footprint. Do we want to take that opportunity? We'll see. Time will tell. Thank you.